Jungfrau Ridge, one of Switzerland's finest mountain panoramas. The Jungfrau Joch, a col between two Bernese peaks, gives rise again and again to the biggest glacier of the Alps. From an altitude of 4,000 meters, the Aletsch Glacier flows for 23 kilometers to its present-day terminus. A glacier begins with falling snowflakes. Over the course of a decade, 1 meter of new snow is compressed into a centimeter of glacier ice. As part of the up to 900 meter thick ice shield, these snowflakes then leisurely wander over centuries down to the valley. At least, it was like this for the longest time. Now this glacial titan is fighting for survival, and with it, soon, all the life that depends on it. Dominik Nellen, a passionate mountain guide, hiked down this path many times as a child, together with his father. The huge ice mass had already fascinated the young boy, and back then, it was even mightier.
20,000 years ago, everything here was covered by glaciers. Only the highest peaks of the surrounding mountains protruded from the ice.
Dominik guides us down to the glacier. He wants to show us the fascinating world of the ice giants from up close. In 1911, J.R.R. Tolkien, author of the Lord of the Rings cycle, hiked across the Alps to Aletsch Glacier. A falling boulder nearly killed him. He took inspiration from this incident. In his best-selling novel, the dwarf-like hobbits experience a dramatic rock slide in the misty mountains. It is inhospitable and mystical at the edge of a glacier. And yet, against all odds, life springs forth from the rocky debris that litters the mountain. The sparse vegetation that grows from fissures in the bedrock is still young. First plants have colonized their new habitat of rocks that have been scoured and smoothed by retreating glaciers. The rocks heat up under the noonday sun. The cool spring water is a welcome treat for hikers. And it reminds Dominik of what Tolkien said about his hike across the glacier. "My heart still lingers among the high stony wastes, among the moraines and mountain wreckage, silent, in spite of the sound of thin, chill water." One 100 years later, the glacier enthusiast is hoping that the creeks will continue to flow here for as long as possible, because the future of the Aletsch is limited. In 1860, this gigantic ice tongue was 3 kilometers longer, and at this spot, it was 200 meters higher. Dominik has reached the ice edge. Broken rocks and scree carried here by the glacier have piled up at the sides. He takes a few steps onto the ice because here, where life doesn't seem possible, Dominik wants to show us some living organisms. Having a firm hold on the ice shield is crucial, and there's no moving forward without steel spikes under one's boots. The hike across the glacier ice is exhausting, and the fear of falling into a crevice never leaves you. Every step comes with the risk of stumbling into a snow-covered abyss. Gaping chasms in the ice can be dozens of meters deep, and even modern crevice rescue techniques can't necessarily help in the event of an emergency. The ice that forms at the glacier's accumulation area flows towards the valley as a tenacious mass, with a speed of 80 to 200 meters per year. Crevices develop because the ice doesn't flow uniformly. Frictional resistance slows the ice movement at the sides and bottom, and these differing speeds lead to tension, which causes the ice crust to split. The search for ice fleas is more difficult than anticipated. A few days ago, there was a heavy downpour, and rainwater killed a lot of the fleas. But luckily, not all of them.
There are ice fleas here.
Fleas are the only species that has adapted to the glacial cold, though it's not actually a flea, but a species of springtail.
Glacier fleas love temperatures ranging from 0 to -3. If it's too warm, they die.
This insect produces a kind of antifreeze from sugar, which allows it to survive on the ice. When the glacier disappears, the fleas disappear with it.
This is the ablation area. Whenever I come here, I check how much melting has occurred over the past days. And I can see that 2 weeks ago, the glacier still went up to here. It hurts to see how much additional ice has been lost in the meantime. Some 150 years ago, the glacier reached all the way up there. In recent times, it has lost all this ice mass.
The glacier is melting at an alarming rate. It loses 1 meter per week, or about 50 meters in length every year. The rocky debris that is pushed along with the ice stream forms the lateral moraines. When two glaciers merge, the dark bands of debris from two glacier edges unite as the medial moraine. At the large Aletsch Glacier, there are actually three neves that merge, thereby forming two medial moraines. These are easily recognizable by dark bands on the ice surface. As a glacier specialist, Dominik is well aware of the danger that lurks below. Glacial crevices have claimed the lives of countless hikers. Their bodies often don't re-emerge for decades, and then as ice mummies. In future, this process probably won't take quite so long. Experts have calculated that the Aletsch Glacier will be gone in 100 years. For Dominik, it's a terrible fault. The lives of many will change radically on ice-free mountains. But when it comes to progressive warming, there aren't just losers. For animals in the High Alps, advancing ice masses once posed the biggest threat. In the mid-19th century, the so-called Little Ice Age caused glaciers to grow dramatically. The ice streams crowded out livestock herds and destroyed farmsteads. The Valais blackneck, a local breed of goat, also saw their habitat dramatically squeezed. And this despite the fact that the undemanding glacier goat, one of the world's oldest house goat species, is extraordinarily well adapted to rugged mountain terrain. With its quaint, mystical look, the Valais blackneck could have sprung from an ancient legend or fairy tale. As the glacier buried more and more pasture land beneath it, hill farmers began to worry about the future of the dairy cows, their sole source of livelihood. A splendid specimen like this requires 100 kilos of fresh grass and succulent herbs every day, and an average of 100 liters of water to go with it. In their desperation, the mountain dwellers erected pilgrimage chapels and organized supplicatory processions. Miraculously, the glacier retreated. A more generous living space was restored to man and animal kind. Sabrina Gurten's family has benefited as well. A farmer's daughter, she spent her childhood summers in the High Alps with the cows. As a budding biologist, nowadays she only has time for this during semester breaks. Her area of specialty, wild bees in high mountain ranges. At an altitude of 2,500 meters, there are enough blossoms to satisfy the young bees, even during the peak of summer. Many bees have specialized in one particular plant species and gather nectar and pollen from it exclusively. Alpine meadows offer a habitat for a great number of flowers. Thanks to their brightly colored petals and interesting forms, they can attract insects to help with pollination. Thistles, however, don't make it easy for their visitors. The 480 wild bee species of Valais, like this bumblebee here, don't produce honey. They collect flower pollen alone for their offspring. Sabrina is studying the shifting of certain species' habitats to higher altitudes, a sure sign of climate change. Heat-sensitive plants are relocating to cooler habitats. The bees specialized in those particular plant species then follow suit.
Here we see the nest hole of a wild bee. It's most likely used as both entrance and exit. Open spaces like this are perfect nesting sites for wild bees because they can get in and out conveniently. Sometimes the females join forces and try to guard one another's nests. When one flies off to gather pollen or nectar, the others stop intruders from taking away their brood.
Catching and examining bees is part of Sabrina's daily routine as a researcher. She does this very carefully to avoid harming them.
This here is a little sand bee that just returned with pollen from woodland geranium flowers. But its pollen baskets are not yet full, so it must fly out again before it can return to the nest. Okay, and now we'll set you free so you can gather more pollen.
As long as enough water gets to the fields and pastures, the wild bees and the pollen donors will be fine. Lush vegetation can be found wherever the nutrient-rich glacial water flows. The Aletsch Glacier is a gigantic water reservoir. If this iceberg were to be melted down, it could supply everyone on Earth with a liter of water per day for 4.5 years. Today, the Aletsch Glacier's ice ends 2,500 meters below its point of origin on the Jungfraujoch. But each year, the ice edge creeps a bit higher. On a hot summer day, 60,000 liters of water leave the glacier's snout in the direction of the Massa Gorge. Since the glacier no longer grows, even in winter, it actually shrinks by an average of 28 meters in length each year. The water masses delight farmers and energy producers. The meltwaters are caught in the Gibbidum Reservoir and guarantee the power plant a steady supply of water. One of Carsten Brügmann's most stunning hunting grounds begins just below the dam. A photographer and biologist, Brügmann hunts for rare orchids in the Massa Gorge, a very special spot. 100 years ago, the young Tolkien also spent time exploring the rock labyrinth below the glacier. He took inspiration from the landscape and the old legends of Valais. Tolkien insiders sense immediately that this is where Middle Earth could be, with its fairy tale elves, hobbits, and trolls. a place where you might expect the halfling Bilbo to emerge from a cave, or Gandalf the magician to pop up from behind a boulder. Even the sober-minded researcher Carsten feels a bit like an intruder here. After all, under King Aragorn, setting foot in the Shire was forbidden and subject to sanctions. The Massa Gorge looks like an enchanted world, with magnificent orchids, dwarf-sized, of course. Even a harmless frog automatically gets one thinking.
This is a heath-spotted orchid, otherwise known as moorland-spotted orchid. You can recognize it easily by the deeply notched labium, or otherwise by the large dark spots on the leaves, the upper side, and on the blossoms. A typical plant for the marshes. It often grows where fresh water flows.
Without the glacier water, the Massa Gorge would be a bleak rock labyrinth.
Dark red hellbrain. It's magnificent how this species is able to survive and scree. In fact, it's a pioneer colonist. It's a pleasure to see these orchids settle and grow in such fresh and also dry scree.
Biologists are particularly interested in the ability of species to adapt to extreme changes in their living conditions. A clear advantage when it gets hotter and drier in the future. The glacier water, which still flows abundantly at this point, allows plants to burst forth in almost subtropical splendor.
The white orchid is rather typical for this altitude on alpine grass. We're at an altitude of about 2,000 meters above sea level. This orchid has a short summer, 1 month to blossom, grow and produce seeds, identifiable by the sweet smell of its blossoms.
The orchid expert is following an ancient irrigation channel, a so-called suoni. The Romans had already diverted glacier water to the dry meadows of the Rhone Valley. Ants have now colonized the disused channels. In sections where a rut couldn't be hewn into the rock, the Suona constructors installed extremely durable larch stems in these lofty heights.
Here we see very impressively how the system's technical sophistication evolved over time. This Suone was first mentioned in around 1385, but it's probably even older, and thus one of the oldest Suones of Valais.
There used to be a dangerously steep path that led through the Massa Gorge. The construction and maintenance of Suones cost many lives.
What we see here is the horizontal plank on the outer edge, the kennel along which the water flowed was on the inside, with another plank on which to walk. Back then, there really was just one plank walk without anything to hold on to.
Years ago, the glacier's ice tongue reached all the way down to the Rhone Valley. In later times, valley dwellers often looked up to the Massa Gorge in a panic, sparked by the sound of a deep, thunder-like rumbling. What followed was a torrent of water and rocks that hurtled towards them from above, destroying countless lives. A folk belief blamed the mythical Rollybock, a giant billy goat with long horns and glowing eyes. The locals used to believe that it was crucial to be in its good graces to avoid catastrophe. When unprovoked, however, the Rollybock was merciful and allowed nutrient-rich glacier milk to flow onto the meadows and pastures. Each farmer was permitted to open their weir only for a precisely specified amount of time. Violations were punished severely. Locals led a hard scrabble life at the Aletsch. The glacier water, however, made things a little more tolerable. And it also created hidden wonderlands, a summertime paradise for countless plants and insects to find ideal living conditions in the warm, moist environment. But this idyll is not surrounded by untouched nature. Livestock pastures and logging make survival more difficult, especially for the stag beetle. The king of insects is in desperate need of help. Theler, a forest warden, and his assistants are stepping into action to save the beetle. They're planning a shelter belt of fortresses, stag beetle fortresses.
Fantastic. Now we have enough wood for a stag beetle fortress.
Because there aren't enough rotting tree stumps in the landscape, the stag beetle lacks living space. The stag beetle fortress is meant to alleviate the situation. But they also hope their new home pleases them.
60 centimeters, not bad. If you take out a little bit more, that would be perfect. Now all we need is a 2 or 3 meter long piece of timber. Attention, 1, 2, 3.
The future inhabitants are demanding. It's important to have the proper soil depth for the right temperature and also protection from robbers. Once the fortress walls are in place, the gaps are filled up with special quick-rotting wood chips. The forest warden hopes that his fosterlings will move in soon. Christian Theler already set up several deadwood fortresses at the edge of the community forest some years ago. And it's become a success story. All of them are occupied by beetle offspring.
The wood has decomposed to a large extent. Here we can see the fungi communities that break down the wood. Stag beetle larvae then feed on the fungi. Here you can see that there's moisture inside. Fungi develop very nicely in this moisture and in rotting wood, and insect larvae feed on it.
The time is ripe for the beetle after an incredibly long larval stage of 5 to 7 years. The male stag beetle leaves the fortress. He has an average lifespan of 3 to 8 weeks. He sets out, and his goal is the next female. Her pheromones lead the way. He climbs towards her determinedly, but an unpleasant surprise awaits. He is not the only suitor of the chosen bug. The newcomer doesn't lose heart, however. He has no choice but to do battle with his rival. The female awaits the outcome. The victor alone has earned the privilege to mate with her. The rivals try to push each other out of the way with their antlers, or try to throw the competitor onto its back. But it doesn't come to this. The weaker beetle concedes and beats a surprising retreat. As he makes his retreat, he gives the bug that spurned him a kick, a sore loser indeed. He seems a bit out of his mind. Was he bewildered by his defeat? Is there some other explanation for his obvious disorientation? Head over heels, the young bug leaves the scene of his defeat by launching himself into flight. him, there will be a second chance somewhere else, if he survives the flight. Christian Theler frets about every single bug. There are, after all, fewer and fewer of them.
It's one of Central Europe's biggest bugs. I saw one for the first time as a child, age 3 or 4. It startled me. I'd never seen such a big bug. I was gripped by the sight, and I've never been able to forget it.
Stag beetles are practically addicted to the nectar of certain trees. It contains sugar and gives them energy for their strenuous flight activities. A juice stain on the bark of the tree has been settled by bacteria that ferment sugar into alcohol. A direct consequence of this is drunken bugs that are left vulnerable to enemy attack. Apparently, ants also love the sweet taste, and they will fight for a place at the feeding site. Despite its tough exoskeleton, the insect suffers when it comes under attack. Ants bite into their joints and force the colossus to flee. It's slowly getting dark, a sultry summer evening after a hot day. But Christian Theler is well aware that new dangers now lurk for his favorite bugs.
A woodpecker absconded with a stag beetle grub that he snatched from the rotting wood. Woodpeckers are enemies of the stag beetle.
For surviving stag beetles, the balmy summer night is the perfect moment for love. Now all the beetle male must do is find the female in the dense foliage. But where there's an instinct-driven will, there is also a way. Mission accomplished. Mating often lasts several days. But danger threatens here too. Woodpeckers skewer the male bugs. The females let themselves drop to the ground. They survive with the fertilized eggs. The next morning, the sun rises brightly over the clouds. It isn't until much later in the day that light falls into the deeply carved glacial valley. The warmth gives rise to humidity. New clouds form. It's unusually quiet on the alpine meadows. The wet conditions are preventing the insects from getting on with their busy lives. But soon, the battle for nectar from the beautiful flowers will be in full swing. The day began gloomily enough under high fog. But locals like Lisa Engler know that in summer, the sun will prevail. At least it usually does. Lisa always gets an early start to gather ingredients for lunch, but only when nature conservation organizations allow this.
Arnica montana is a lovely medicinal plant that's found only in the Alpine region. It was popularly used to treat many ailments. Ointments were made with it, or it was used in alcoholic extracts for external application rather than ingesting. Schnapps, after all, could be found in most households. The blossoms were steeped in alcohol from which a tincture was obtained, a strong one. It was rubbed onto the body, and not just humans, but animals were also treated with it.
As a herbalist, Lisa doesn't have to look long for edible flowers and useful herbs. Mountain pastures with their incredible biodiversity offer a lavish supply during the summer months.
This is extraordinarily delicious. Bell flower is slightly sweet. When it comes to the world of blossoms, it's my favorite. I use it to decorate salads or put it in quark. It has a very delicate sweet taste. Less delicate, but no less delicious, is Alpine Dock. You can make rhubarb compote using the stems. It belongs to the same family as rhubarb and also has a very similar flavor. The leaves can be used as a substitute for spinach. It's a crop plant, and in the past it was used for wrapping butter so that it could be transported from the alpine pastures. GM Albanum, or wood avens, is a cultivated plant. In this region, children used to gather it. From their village, they climbed high up into the alpine pastures and collected it by the kilo, roots, leaves and blossoms, up to 10 kilos per person and day. It was then taken to the village store, where herbal heart and nerve drops were made, using the whole herb, plus its roots. I use the roots when I have a gum infection. I just put some in my mouth and gently chew on it to extract the juice. I also make a tincture from the roots. This way I have the medication available even when there are 2 meters of snow outside.
Das Medikament auch zur Verfügung, wenn hier 2 Meter Schnee liegen.
In 2017, even less rain fell in Valais than usual, and many a blossom is now wilting before its time. But Lisa Engler can still be choosy on the mountainsides behind the glacier, where she picks only the most succulent plants and berries.
What we here have is rampion, or devil's claw. It's a wonderful culinary herb. We can collect the blossom in this state. They're then chopped or even roasted whole in a pan. Rampion goes well with vegetables or meat.
Oder auch zu Fleisch.
Lisa is not the only one who savors the plants that grow here. She specifically goes to meadows on which she hasn't yet encountered any rivals for these herbs, namely cows and sheep.
This is rock thyme. Another name for it is Thymus alpinus. And it never grows taller than these bushes. It is said to be a very warming plant, and it's growing in abundance this year. I come across it all the time. I see them everywhere. It seems to be telling me that I will still be needing it this year. I'm going to make an ointment out of it, one that I can use this winter to treat a cough.
In previous times, harvesting wild plants was the basis for nourishment and medicine. Mountain farmers ensured their own survival this way too. If it weren't for modern herbalists like Lisa Engler, this old knowledge would soon be lost forever. Peter Aschilier, a forest warden, is worried about his mountain forest, especially in summer. He's asked Sandy, a paraglider pilot, to keep an eye on the situation from above. The trees are in distress because of the heat, and the area is also experiencing a deer plague. The weather is changing again.
Doesn't look good, but if the weather holds up for the next half an hour or so, it could stay up there. It's just it'll be dark down there.
Fischer Alp is one of the preferred launch sites for long-distance flights across the Alps. Today, however, the pilot is not straying from the local mountain. He will be acting as an airborne spy camera for the forest warden.
I'm curious as to whether he will see game or not. I told him where to fly. He'll call me later and then we'll meet up. It'll be interesting to see what kind of game he saw and where. Hunters will be delighted if he sees a lot of game. The forest, on the other hand, will prefer a bit less of it.
A growing deer population is taking over the mountain forest as their habitat and eating the plant shoots as they emerge. This is a death sentence for such forests that are actually meant to protect us and nature from dangerous weather phenomena and climate change. Trees that are part of the Bardewald are losing their footing across extensive areas. If the mountainside suffers a massive landslip, it will destroy the Upper Valais' most important road access. The Matterhorn-Gotthard railway line and Furkestrasse are in imminent danger. A catastrophe threatens in the Rhone Valley. Aschilier, the forest warden, is called upon to avert a calamity at practically any cost. The unstable precipice is located due south, beyond the idyllic alpine meadow. The forest world seems to still be intact on the densely wooded eastern slope. Appearances are deceptive, however. Peter Aschilier's special problem zone begins behind the protective fence, his personal battlefield against forest dieback.
If you look at this zone, you might not think that anything has happened there. But in fact, we've been fighting for every single tree there over the past 30 years.
The south-facing slopes of the Rhone Valley have always been extremely dry, and global warming is magnifying this phenomenon. Hardly a plant can support itself on the steep bedrock. If global warming continues unchecked, the entire alpine region could soon look like the Bardewald forest. A nightmare scenario, not just for foresters. Irrigation and reforestation hasn't helped, and to complicate things further, deer have invaded the area. A vicious cycle that the forest warden hopes to disrupt.
Here we are at an animal crossing. Deer come up here and bite into the young shoots. We put up a deer fence so that the plants can grow undisturbed within this area.
Where properly protected, the forest will recover. Juniper, barberry, birch, pine and whitebeam are among the first pioneer plants to stabilize the slope. Aschilier is hopeful, unless, of course, temperatures get even warmer.
Protected by such shrubs as barberry, whitebeam is able to rejuvenate, but it takes a long time. The whitebeam here is 30 years old.
The unpredictable consequences of climate change make any kind of accurate forecast impossible. At this point, the Bardewald forest has not yet been saved for the long term. Any progress could still be undone by some misfortune. But the inhabitants of the Aletsch Glacier region know from experience that prayers and magic incantations alone are of no help. Taking action is urgently required. If the entire mountain slope fails and plunges straight down, it will first block the Rhone River and then ravage everything in its way, bringing death and destruction to the people living downstream. The alpine world with its ancient trees left a deep impression on the young Tolkien when he hiked along the Aletsch Glacier. In fact, it inspired Mirkwood and the mythical creatures in Lord of the Rings. Their long curved horns certainly give the alpine ibex a fabled look. While this type of wild goat usually spends its time at high altitudes during the hot summer months, it sometimes climbs down to the mountain forests. All the while, these shy animals are constantly on guard, especially when they are with their young, which are born in springtime. A kid ibex will follow its mother for up to a year. Animals and plants have grown accustomed to the sparse living conditions of the alpine glacier world. They defy wind and weather, even at an altitude of 2,500 meters above sea level. If they are given enough time, they will be able to adapt. The legendary Swiss stone pine thrives particularly well in the Aletsch forest. It can even withstand temperatures of minus 30 degrees Celsius. Swiss pines extend their branches fairy tale-like. In Tolkien's fictional world, the mighty queen of Gondor's name, Arwen, takes its cue from a German word for Swiss pine. This Swiss pine tree, however, is inhabited by perfectly normal little dwarfs. An ant colony has settled on its roots, an abode with a several hundred year lease. Indestructible as they look, Swiss pines need help now. Peter Aschilier is desperately looking for donors with deep pockets who are willing to help conserve his endangered forest. Many a veteran tree has already been standing here for almost a millennium. The forester launched an online archive, including GPS data, in which he documents the trees to be saved with the help of tree sponsors. At 2,200 meters, the air at the Riederhorn Mountain is quite thin, even for a mountain forest. Here, the future belongs to the survival experts. Even bonsai format trees make it into the archive. Some of these pint-sized trees have been fighting to survive for decades, and tribute must be paid to them. An eccentric millionaire from London realized a quirky dream at the foot of the Riederhorn. Today, environmentalists use the 100-year-old Villa Cassell. Laudo Albrecht, a biologist, heads the Pro-Natura Center. He's not only fighting for the Aletsch forest, he's trying to protect the extraordinary biodiversity of the entire glacier region. Especially dear to Laudo's heart is the marmot. Although it has learned to live in close proximity to people, it's very shy and hides underground.
In part, their summer burrows are very long. Marmots dig complex tunnel networks 15 to 20 centimeters below the earth. They have several entrances, and it's not unusual for a marmot to disappear into a hole of their summer burrow, only to reappear someplace else completely. This entire area sits above extensive tunnel systems.
Caution is required in marmot territory. They wreak havoc in their meadow habitats, leaving holes and collapsed tunnels everywhere.
Ah, lovely. Marmot pups, when they are born at the beginning of June, only weigh 30 to 40 grams. And by the time they enter their first hibernation period, they already weigh some 1,500 grams. In other words, they increase their body weight by a factor of 50, a sensational result for such a short time. As soon as they emerge from the tunnel system, the main thing they have to do is eat, and then eat some more so they can increase their body fat stores beyond maintenance level and survive their first winter sleep.
Ja,
The problem is that marmots cannot sweat like we do. They don't have sweat glands, and this could pose a problem in connection with global warming. The warmer it gets, the more time they will have to spend in their cool burrows. And there, of course, they can neither enjoy life nor eat, which makes it difficult to accumulate the fat reserves necessary to survive the whole winter from October to mid-April. The territory that marmots occupy is carefully protected against invaders. And to ensure that this territory doesn't become overpopulated, male marmots behave aggressively towards the sub-adults, the two-year-old animals. These then leave their natal home site to find a new place to live and perhaps a partner to reproduce with. This prevents marmot colonies from becoming overpopulated.
The peace and quiet above the glacier is deceptive. The weather can quickly turn into storms and torrential downpours, sometimes with terrible consequences. Previous generations that lived here were at the mercy of the forces of nature. They erected crosses and chapels for protection and hoped that prayers and processions would avert impending doom. Valaisans are God-fearing, and they've always been a bit superstitious. They nail images of saints and magic symbols to their houses. In 1678, Pope Innocent allowed the inhabitants of Fichatal to hold an annual supplicatory procession to plead for divine intervention against the glacier's menacing growth. By 2010, however, the devout villagers were praying for the opposite, once again with permission from the Vatican. Now they pray for the end of climate change, global warming, and glacial melting. But the odds are not in their favor unless a miracle happens. Forecasts indicate that almost all of the glaciers will be gone in 100 years. At that point, only last remnants of the Aletsch Glacier will probably still remain. Enormous glacial flanks will spill down into the valley, and this time, it's scientists who are making the prediction, and not authors of fantasy fiction.